Unreal. Everyone, Flo Mounier. That was insane, man.
Thank you very much.
The power and the energy coming from you playing there was just unreal. And the song you just opened up with was from your band.
Yes, Cryptopsy. Cryptopsy, yeah.
And the song was called, was it Shag Harbor Visitors?
Yeah, Shag Harbor Visitors, yeah.
Awesome. Guys, welcome Flo Mounier to Drumeo. He's here to talk about heavy metal drumming and more specifically, five tips for heavy metal drummers.
Yeah, five that'll turn into 25. But yeah, we're here to talk about things that drummers, in general, we can classify it by, you know, heavy metal drummers. But it's things that we all kind of need to work on, mm-hmm. or, you know, tips that work for me.
Yep.
So they may not work for everybody else.
Yep.
Hopefully they will. And they touch on things that have to do with metal, but also drumming in general. So.
Awesome.
Had to find a name for it.
Yeah, exactly. Before we get into it, let's just talk a little bit about yourself. I'm not sure if everybody knows who Flo is yet. If not, go and check him out. You can find him on Facebook, facebook.com/FloMounier01. And spelling of your name is Mounier.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay, good. I didn't want to get that one wrong.
Very Scottish.
Yeah, yeah, very exactly. And your band, Cryptopsy?
Cryptopsy, yeah.
You've been playing with them for how long?
I've been playing with Cryptopsy for over 20 years.
Holy cow.
So, yeah, we've been in it from the beginning of this extreme kind of metal, death metal genre. And, you know, been doing other things, of course, as well, other projects and other songs that I'll be touching on later on in the lesson. And yeah, for Cryptopsy right now, actually, we're just in the middle of getting songs together.
Yeah.
And probably heading out on tour end of the year, Europe and the States, and probably Canada.
That's awesome. And you can find them on facebook.com/cryptopsymetal. So go and like them on Facebook, guys. Show them some support. You also have a DVD out, Extreme Metal Drumming.
Yeah, Extreme Metal Drumming 101, which came out, I think, in 2005.
Okay.
So it's a little dated, but there's stuff on there, instructional stuff that's really relative,
yeah.
And I might touch on some of those today, only because it's hard to get away from doing the actual work, mm-hmm. to get the results that that one needs.
Yeah, absolutely. So go and find them on Facebook. FloMounier.com as well for your main website. You're going to be doing Skype lessons coming up very soon as well. So you have a lot going on.
Mm-hmm.
And before we get into the lesson, I just want to say a huge thanks to Darren and everybody at Roland for helping bring you out here.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. And also for all your other sponsors, Pearl, Sabian, Vic Firth, Evans, Bill Did It. You also
Bill
do
it.
Some yeah. Bill Did It stuff. Check that out over there. So
yeah, excellent. Excellent. Technology, and I mean, excellent sponsors all around. I love the cymbals I use. The tones are amazing. You know, these drums are actually a Visions kit, so midline, but they sound great, and I love playing with them. A lot of flexibility. Evans heads, so innovative. And can't forget the Vic Firth sticks.
Yeah,
great absolutely. Stuff. And then showcasing the new Roland TM-2
yeah.
module.
Yeah, that's coming out this year. We'll talk more about that towards the end. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of questions about that. And again, I just want to apologize. I pronounced your last name wrong.
It's Mounier.
Mounier.
And it's, yeah, it's not an easy one to pronounce.
No, so I apologize.
It's okay.
Rookie mistake.
It's all good.
So let's get into it. So, guys... Okay. For all you guys who are new, if you have questions throughout this lesson, right below the video, there's a submit a question link. You should know that by now, but if you guys are watching for the first time, make sure you submit your questions that way. The chat's too fast for me to follow. Towards the end, we'll get to as many questions as possible. If you are new, welcome. So let's get into it. So five tips for metal drumming. Take it away.
Well, first tip is everybody should grow a beard.
Yes. Tip number one.
Tip number one. Tip number two, better have one of these around.
Yeah.
Okay. Three, water essential. Four, we're missing today. A fan is really good because you can overheat and die of dehydration and all that stuff. And then five, I forget. So that's pretty much it.
Yeah, thanks for
Thank
the lesson,
you.
Everybody.
Take care.
Take those tips to your kit.
All right, let's get serious. Five tips. There's going to be three that are kind of grouped and. Okay, let's start with five tips. first of all, most metal drummers need endurance.
Yes.
Most drummers need endurance. Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll cover that. Endurance is a big key. In metal, you can go fast and you can go slow. If you choose to go fast, we'll talk about ways of going faster. Third would be power. And again, that goes for any type of drumming, but power is important in metal because it's usually at high velocities that we play. We have to compete with raging, distorted guitars and huge bass cabinets and all that stuff. So usually a strong hit is important. But what we're going to touch on later on is also the importance of having a powerful hit in order to create dynamics, because if you have a powerful hit, most likely you can have a light touch as well. So mm-hmm. we'll touch on those.
Okay.
We'll touch about talk about creativity, because this type of music that Cryptopsy's done, that metal does in general, whether it's extreme or black metal or new metal or what have you, has no real barriers as far as your creativity. There's nobody behind the board saying there's too many snare hits during that measure, obviously for the Cryptopsy stuff and other bands as well. So you have to be creative in order to be different. Mm-hmm. And that could be applicable for a drummer or a guitar player or vocalist or whatever. But creativity is quite important. Mm-hmm. And then we'll talk a little bit about if metal drummers have the right attitude, just like any other musician in any other style, chances are you'll probably be called upon for more gigs, mm-hmm. for you know, more work and more fun if you enjoy doing your work.
Exactly.
So endurance, speed, power, creativity, attitude.
Perfect. Let's start at the top.
All right.
Endurance.
Let's start with endurance. So, yeah. A lot of the stuff I'm going to be talking about, I have to kind of show you, and you have to kind of internalize it and start to feel it. What I recommend for any drummer at any level is to have a metronome and a stopwatch. Now, there are apps on your, you know, smartphones that have both incorporated, which is great.
Yeah.
The metronome is your measurement, is the measurement of your growth, of your success. Not only that, it's also incredibly important to get used to playing with a metronome if you're tracking and if you're playing with different projects. It's really the only way that you know where you are. Mm-hmm. I don't have to go on about that. I think we all pretty much know that.
Yeah, yeah.
The stopwatch is really for the endurance, because if you play at a certain speed, let's say I play, if I played for 10 seconds, I'm not really playing it. I have to really be able to play it for a sustained amount of time in order for my mind to start recognizing it as a common movement. Therefore, my muscles get used to it and you can grow. And you can watch from your BPMs increasing that you're growing. So I recommend that you do any exercise, whether it be for feet or for hands, for at least a minute and up. That'd be like minimum.
Yeah.
But the more I get into teaching and actually applying it on myself, because I went to the University of Trial and Error to learn my drums. The more I try things, the more I find that like 5 minutes and over is, you know, and longer. It just you know, your body's an amazing tool, but it all stems from here. So in order for patterns to obviously sink in, they have to be repeated and repeated over and over again for it to lock in. And there's also a maintenance phase. So I'll give you an example of something that you would do. You would set your metronome, let's say, to 140 to start, or 120 or 1, whatever you want. I'm going to go and do basically eighth notes over, let's say, 140, so maybe it's I'm going to simplify things because you can go 1 foot at a time, which I do recommend. You can go both feet at a time, and then there's rudiments to do, and et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
So let's start off at one tempo and go for at least a minute. I'm going to start playing heels up.
Okay.
And I'm going to show you the heels up technique afterwards because it's very special, if you wish.
Okay.
And I'll just play. I'll give myself a count and play kind of a. In order for it to get, you know, stay a little bit more interesting, I'll just probably add a beat to it with the hands. Okay?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, you get the idea. This has got to be done for at least a minute. And I recommend at slower tempos like that to do it for 5 minutes, okay?
Okay.
Now, what I'm doing as far as the technique goes, and this is why endurance, speed, and power kind of all can be done at the same time, so be hit on at the same time.
Sure.
I'm doing a movement where I'm lifting, so I'm playing heels up, but when I'm coming back down, my foot comes back down. So every time there's like a fraction of a second or a millisecond of rest on each foot. So if everybody wants to, or if you can or are able to, try to do this, is that you're trying to raise your leg mm-hmm. by using your foot. So you're kind of rolling on the ball of your foot and you're lifting up your leg. And the reason why I'm doing this and not just using my hip flexors is to save energy, to save my hip flexors. You can hurt yourself really, really bad with too much hip flexor movement or a strain or what have you. So I'm limiting the amount of work that my leg has to do, which is my quad muscle right here,
yep.
the front of my leg, limiting that to save energy and also to increase the amount of play I have with my ankle. Because when you get to faster speeds, it's not as much legs anymore that does the work, it's the ankle that does the work. Mm-hmm. So in order for the ankle to do more work, you have to train it. So this motion right here is actually training the ankle. It's contracting the calf muscle, and that's one of the muscles that you want to basically utilize to move the ankle. The other muscle is the shin muscle, okay? So when you raise your foot, your shin muscle contracts. When you lower your foot, your calf muscle contracts. And that's basically the motion of your ankle hitting the pedal.
Gotcha, yeah.
Okay? And I'll show you a little bit more detail, like exercises that you can do outside the kit that'll be actually really good for
Very
you.
Very cool, yeah.
So that'll be one endurance exercise. And all you do is raise up the BPMs. When you start getting to a higher BPM, well, then you're utilizing speed and endurance. In utilizing speed, like I said, your technique kind of changes where now it becomes the ankle doing most of the movement because it's a smaller muscle, so you can go faster without using up as much energy.
Okay.
All right. Okay, so endurance, over a minute, and that's for the feet. Hands, I mean, it's the same thing. What I really recommend for endurance exercises for the hands would be to play on a kit. And the reason is because you want your brain to begin to get familiar with the placement of your drums and your different colors on the kit at the same time. So you want to try to, you know, save your time as much as possible and utilize your time of practice as much as possible. So if I'm just to do, you know, a kind of exercise where it'd be like, and you do that for an extended period of time, and we're just, you know, utilizing singles right now. We'll get to different rudiments a little bit later on. So all it is putting the time in. And if you noticed, I'm doing something at the same time. There's lots of subjects here that'll be encroaching on each other. Okay. We all have stronger and weaker limbs.
Yep.
And we want to remedy that as much as possible when we practice. So I was giving myself, and I mean, ideally, you'd have the metronome going in your ears loud enough so you can hear it. And I was giving a count with my left foot, which is weaker than my right foot, just so that when I'm practicing these things for a long period of time, well, I'm getting the practice in with my weak foot at the same time, right? So any exercises that I would do where I'd be just like doing hand stuff, I'll give an example again. So on and so forth, and I mean, if you get, you know, raise it up a bit. And the whole point in doing that too is try to forget your foot. Your foot's following a metronome, so you're trying to forget your foot so it's as relaxed and comfortable as possible, and you focus more on your hands and you know, going around the kit. So very simple stuff, and of course, you can try a whole bunch of different rudiments on. It's just a really great thing for your brain and, of course, for your muscles to memorize.
So you're just basically doing, is it just basically singles just on any kind of drum slash cymbal while keeping time with your right or left foot?
That's one exercise you can do to keep your, you know, your weak foot, let's say, playing a lot, because, you know, when you're playing songs and stuff like that and your weak foot is your weak foot, me being right-handed, or, you know, that's the case. When I try to do practice stuff, I try to incorporate a lot more, so, you know, kind of like tries to get up to par with the right one. But a lot of the time when you start, you know, getting into different rudiments around the kit at different tempos, just to practice the endurance and the speed, and even the power, because what you can do when you're doing your foot movement and stuff like that is exaggerate the stroke and create a greater rung, a greater range of motion in order to work more muscles at the same time while working your muscle faster, so you spend less time having to do the exercises.
So you're all about efficiency when it comes to practice.
I try because, you know, we're limited in time during the day, and also because I've started to study a lot more about how the human body works and what it responds to and what have you, and I have a personal trainer certificate.
Oh, cool.
And just doing that whole, you know, process taught me a lot about, you know, different things that you can apply to make things easy. Because the overall goal to achieve with all this, whether it be metal drumming or jazz drumming or rock drumming, is to play in a relaxed way. So to be as relaxed as possible. And it's very hard to achieve sometimes, playing like the type of music that we do. But therefore, it's important to utilize the right muscle to do the right movement instead of being tense and using nerves and, you know, overworking your body and depleting your energy a lot faster.
Absolutely.
So absolutely, efficiency is definitely one of the keys.
Question for you about your endurance. You're talking about one of the key tips for this lesson is practice your endurance. Do you first extend the amount of time that you're practicing the exercise for, or do you increase the tempo? I always found that I was never sure what I should increase first, the tempo or the time that I practice.
I think that the best way to go is to start off slow. Okay. So you start off at a slow BPM. When you start off at a slow BPM, you can practice it for a long time. Mm-hmm. As you start raising your BPMs, you're going to find your body is not going to be able to last as long.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's just, you know, 2+2 logistics. So at first, get really comfortable, because when you practice slow for an extended period of time, you're actually helping with your speed Because your body is still memorizing the movement. And the slower you go, actually, the more detailed that mind-muscle connection becomes mm-hmm. when you're practicing, you know, let's just say like singles on the feet.
Yeah.
When you start practicing rudiments with your feet, practice them really slow so that as you increase, the mind's already kind of, you know, got the motion going.
Yeah.
So it just commands the muscle to do to the right movement.
So you play these shows, sometimes an hour, sometimes maybe even 2 hours long, mm-hmm. and you're blasting, you're playing so much energy on the kit. So what is your go-to exercise when it comes to practicing endurance? And if it is just as simple as setting your metronome up, what is your routine in doing that, and how did you develop that endurance?
It's like I said, it's kind of a mixture of the endurance and the speed one. When you talk about endurance, you talk about a long period of time, or when you talk about working out, you talk about a lot of repetitions. Mm-hmm. Okay. When we compare it to speed, in order to jump a little bit of the topic here, let's go to speed. Now, the speed is utilizing muscle to its full potential.
Yep.
So, without nerves. Okay. So for the speed exercise, and this all ties in with endurance and power as well, but it's basically pushing yourself. I find that in order to have dynamic and power and control and endurance, I, for my hands, use my wrists first and foremost.
Okay.
Fingers afterwards are like icing on the cake. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's just the extra little push for the speed. So the point would be in doing speed and power building exercises to push the muscles that control the wrist, basically the top of the forearm and the bottom of the forearm. When you hit down, this muscle contracts. When you lift the stick, this muscle contracts. Okay? So, I mean, there's even exercises with weights that you can do to improve that.
Okay, yeah.
But what I would like recommend to do, because you're working and encompassing you're doing all three at the same time, so endurance, speed, and power, is let's say we do the same kind of exercises with metronome, at like start at 140 for a certain period of time. Now, I don't recommend playing like this. I recommend doing the exercise like this.
Okay.
You really close your fingers on the stick.
Okay.
So no fingers at all, and basically no arms either.
Okay.
So I would just do, let's say, single strokes with just the wrist. So. Tell when your forearms start to get like kind of warmed up, you know?
Yeah.
What I try to do also when I do exercises like that is I break it up. I'll do the hands for like a minute or over, and then I'll do the feet so that when I bump up the BPMs and come back to my hands have had a little rest, because it's important to rest the muscles so that the lactic acid can disperse and mm-hmm. you can go on and have, you know, good energy. So I kind of exaggerate the motion as well. And the range of motion, right? So I'm utilizing more muscle. At a certain tempo, obviously, you can't lift as high and you can't go as fast without using fingers, but the whole point for speed would be to try to practice to your maximum just using wrists. So build your wrists. There's reasons you look at a drummer, and I'll give you some examples. You look at a drummer who's a big boy, mm-hmm. all right? You look at their forearms. Mm-hmm. They got really big forearms. You look at their style when they play. And most of the time, it's going to be all wrist and a lot of control and a lot of speed mm-hmm. with just the wrists. You look at other drummers that aren't as big, that are a little bit skinnier, a lot of the times, they're going to talk about technique, mm-hmm. finger technique, hand technique, molar technique, and stuff like that,
yeah.
that they apply in order to go fast. The thing that everybody has to realize is that wrists are extremely powerful. The combination of a little bit of wrist and arm as a far and fingers at the end for a whipping motion can be the strongest hit you can do. Mm-hmm. But you got to develop that muscle. So in order to develop your forearms, you really got to close your fingers and just concentrate on developing that. I'll show you, like I said, exercises that you can do off the kit that are really good for that in a little bit. So for speed, you got to push yourself. You got to push yourself as far as you can go, and you know, maybe not the next day. If you have a regiment of practice and you do this, the speed and endurance type of exercises, which only should take you about half an hour to 40 minutes in a session of practice, I would suggest that you maybe leave a day off afterwards. So every other day, just in, you know, especially at first, because if your muscle is sore and you feel it sore the next day, it's because it's rebuilding.
Yeah.
It's recuperating. And muscle grows at rest. So only when it stops being sore can you work it again. Mm-hmm. Same thing for the feet. So I'm going to try to use, you know, that technique that I showed you where I'm using my leg to come down on the pedal, and I'm going to try to push it as far as I can go before I isolate the leg and before it's only ankle during the motion.
Okay.
So I'll try to do something with just one foot to show you guys. See, I'm using a lot of power and I'm using a lot of leg and push when I'm doing that. Same thing if I was to do both feet. I don't know if people can see it or not, but I'm really using leg and ankle to really kind of hammer away at it. And the point is to go, like I said, push that muscle to its limit before you can start developing a new technique. And that fluidity of changing things will come later. And especially if you use the technique I showed you before, where you're just lifting. You're lifting your whole leg with your ankle. There's not much difference between that movement and just the ankle movement. So we'll get into that as well. Okay.
Okay, so we talked about speed.
Talked about speed.
Talked about endurance. We've talked a little bit about power too.
Right.
Let's go into the last two because we do have questions at the end. We're already 40 minutes in.
Are we?
Time flies, man.
Okay, let me can I mention something really quickly before?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Just in comparisons to weak and strong limbs, because that's really important when developing these things, because you want to isolate them. If you have a weak limb, let's say you have a weak left hand, okay, and you want to work on the double stroke, because rudiments are super important for the creativity, which we're getting into, a factor of drumming. When I was younger, I had a few teachers, and I asked them about the, I guess, the way, the best way to get my double strokes up to par. And there was no right answer, right? There's nothing that really worked. And so I would try double stroke, and I would always find that my left hand was the weakest. So, like. For some reason, I couldn't get the left hand. So a really, really good trick for anybody, and this applies for the feet too, is to do triplets.
Okay.
Because, I mean, if your right hand is fine with the doubles, you don't have to really concentrate on your right hand when you're doing a triplet kind of roll. So you isolate your left hand and you kind of focus on it. So, you know. So right, left, left, right, left, left, right, left, left, in case that your hand is weaker. And then same thing with the feet. I mean, if you have time to practice this and you want to kind of get even with your limbs, it's a great exercise that helped me develop my double stroke. So I said, well, you know, why not use it on my feet? So I'm going to be the same kind of. And when I do stuff like that, I try not to get off balance. I try to be as grounded as possible. And this is why I'll have to show you that technique after. Okay, let's go and you tell me what's next, the creativity?
Creativity, yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right.
Especially in metal drumming, because it seems like a lot of times you just hear tons of blasts and stuff, so it's really tough, in my opinion, to be a really creative metal drummer. So.
Well, that's the thing. It's a kind of a double-edged sword, okay?
Yeah.
You have like a limitless palette of any kind of styles to choose from, mm-hmm. but you got to apply it to usually this kind of fast-paced, high-energy kind of music.
Yeah.
So you're kind of limited in your, you know, in your time signatures. I mean, you know, you can be playing at 220 beats per minute, and if you do a roll that's in, I don't know, quarter note triplets, when you're playing, let's say, in 32nd notes or in, you know, 18th notes or 18th note triplets, it's really going to slow the whole music down, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So your palette is kind of limited. So I mean, you can't really go like, without the whole thing going,
yeah.
you know? So you're kind of limited as far as that goes. But this is why rudiments are super important. And it's starting to really shine now in metal, and it, you know, more so than in the past, is that you really have to know your basics. And rudiments are super important. A double stroke will add, you know, just a little bit more feel to stuff, and it'll open doors, you know, flams, paradiddles, a whole bunch of different stuff. I mean, we all know that it's super important. Now, the point is to actually sit down and do these mm-hmm. on the endurance level, on the speed level, on the power level, okay? It makes a huge difference. If I do just like a normal double bass beat, and then I do the same beat, adding a little bit of like ghost noting with doubles and stuff like that, it's gonna make a huge difference. So let me try to do that
sure,
for you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, very plain Jane kind of thing, and then.
Yeah.
And it's just basic rudiments that should be incorporated in every style, and everybody, sorry, I think I fling some water. everybody already knows it and stuff, but it's actually getting down to it and doing it in the same veins as we just talked about for all the, you know, the three first things. So creativity. Next in creativity is obviously listening to other, you know, kinds of music.
Yeah, yeah.
Listening to other drummers. Mm-hmm. Because if it all comes down to it, it's just drumming. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's different feels and different touch for different music, but it's all applicable. So as much as possible, you know, without necessarily, if time permits, yes, absolutely. Try different Latin beats. Try to go into jazz. Try to take different lessons from different teachers of different styles. But most importantly is listening to other types of music and trying to get into it and trying to focus on, well, you know, what is this? There's a lot of times when we did albums for Cryptopsy in the past where I'd be influenced by a Dave Weckl album mm-hmm. and a certain thing that we did in a blast kind of like, you know, version. But it's still those influences that kind of made me get away from, let's say, just the speed and just the sheer brutality of it and try to experiment with things in order to create something a little bit different. So creativity is quite important and can be attained very easily by just opening up your mind. And since, like I had mentioned before, the metal scene doesn't really have any regulations. There's no set rules. Mm-hmm. Okay, there's no clean singing.
Yeah.
That's a
yeah, exactly.
Inside thing.
Okay.
But there's no rules, you know what I mean? You can do whatever you want, and you're doing music for yourself first and foremost. And if you're happy with the music you do yourself, then usually other people will probably share in that opinion and that joy. So be creative and try things, man. Try different things.
I know creativity is always a really tough one to teach, and we get a lot of questions about that in Drumeo too. It's like, well, how do I get creative? How do I, you know? But you nailed it. And you just listen to more music try applying those rudiments, like you were saying, like mm-hmm. even like a double or whatever. And I know when I used to play heavy metal, I didn't play a lot of it, but I didn't do a lot of rudimental stuff. I was always singles, you know.
Right, right.
Because I never thought that style favored rudiments or that kind of stuff, right?
Absolutely, right. Yeah.
So let's quickly talk about the last little point there about just attitude. Now, this one seems pretty obvious to have a good attitude, but why don't you talk on that a little bit?
Well, it's really key. I've been in different projects, involved in different projects, worked with a whole bunch of different people, and had bandmates come and go throughout the years. And not to say that I'm an example of attitude, because no, I've learned a lot. You know, I used to be this way, I used to be that way, and people change also as they evolve and get older and what have you. But the right attitude as far as an approach of open-mindedness, as far as saying or being able to say, yes, I'd like to have your input on what you'd like me to play, without necessarily saying, well, no, I play this certain way and this is the only thing I'm going to do on your album if you want me. I mean, it comes down to the joy of music. If you enjoy playing drums, you can enjoy playing drums in a country band, you can enjoy playing drums in a grind band, you can enjoy playing drums in a jazz, rock, whatever. It's all about kind of being open-minded and thinking that all the different things that you do and all the people that you meet and give respect before respect is given to you will teach you in a certain way. So attitude is quite important as far as responding, and especially the initial response to people you meet, projects you do, bandmates. Try to make it easy, because it's metal's a tough business. Music in general nowadays is tough because of music not selling as much as it used to, because it's available for free. You know, so you really have to be open-minded, you have to be positive, and you have to have the right attitude in order to do what you love doing, which is, I hope, playing drums. Be positive.
Yeah.
You know? Positivity really goes a long way, you know? And if you're always kind of negative and kind of unsure about things, that usually comes and hits you afterwards, you know, in the back of the head. And
even if you're not in a band, or in a situation where you have to impress people, even on your own, like the attitude towards watching other videos online, you know, judgmental, you know, such a negative tone around watching those videos, how are you going to be inspired to go and play, right?
It's important to maybe before you speak your mind, which I'm not saying not to, obviously everybody's entitled to speak their mind, but maybe, you know, think about something that's creative, constructive, instead of blatantly mean. You know, and my father always told me, if you have nothing good to say, don't say anything at all. And
absolutely.
You know what? It kind of it's kind of true. You know, it's. But constructive criticism is super, and I, you know, as far as the internet reactions and stuff like that, I think that it's it helps in every which way.
Cool. Okay, so those are tips that go across all genres of music. It's not just heavy metal.
Absolutely.
But with heavy metal, one of the biggest things is that power and is that endurance and that speed. So to kind of wrap things up here a little bit on the teaching side, what would be maybe, and you were talking about some exercises that you can do without the feet, what are like maybe three or four exercises that you go, your go-to exercises for developing, especially that speed with your feet and also that speed with your left hand with those blasts that we can maybe share?
Okay, it's very simple. If people want to try this out, it's actually kind of fun. If you can tap your fingers like this on one hand.
Okay.
Now try it with the other hand. Is it a little bit more awkward, or is
it
the same?
A little bit more awkward.
Okay. Here's the deal with me.
Okay.
For some reason, my fingers are quicker on my right hand, but my wrist is quicker on my left hand.
Okay.
But this exercise shows me that it's these muscles right here that are moving my fingers, right? So what do I have to do? Well, I have to practice the forearms more on my right hand to get it up to par with my left hand. Okay.
Yep.
Now, that's one thing you can do. If you're not the same this way, well then just practice with your weak hand.
So literally just doing this.
Just do this.
Just tapping.
Because you're really working all these different muscles in your forearms. Okay?
I do that all the time.
Yeah. I usually do too, and I always with my left.
So, right.
Try to get it close. I mean, the best advice I can do for give you for that is try to mirror exactly what the strong hand does. And when I say mirror, I say what feeling when you close your eyes do you get internally? Mm-hmm. Okay?
Okay.
So there's that. Okay, I'm just going to back up a little bit here.
Okay.
Let's go for the hands since we're on that, or the wrists. A great one for the wrist is very simply, and I'll use my stool here to prop up my leg, get a more parallel angle. Okay, very simple for the wrist. You lock in your forearm, okay. So you're not using any arm, and you're just using wrist and the forearm muscles to do the movement. And what you want to do is exaggerate this.
Okay.
Okay? You want to exaggerate that movement, because remember, range of motion RUM recruits more muscles when you do a greater, when you have a greater range of movement.
And okay? I'm feeling a burn now already.
Right. So you're just using a wrist, right?
Yeah.
So this is good for endurance, because obviously you're doing it for a long time.
Yeah.
If you wanted to build up your arm and build up the strength of your arm, you'd actually have to do weights. But this is great to warm up, and this is what I do to warm up when I don't have any sticks or pads or whatever.
Okay.
Here's the clincher. All right. This looks kind of funny.
Okay.
But this way.
Same idea?
Same idea. Now you wanna lock that arm onto your knee.
Yeah.
And you wanna come down as far as you can go with your hand, and then okay. Come up high. Okay, and you're gonna feel this burn fast.
Oh yeah.
Okay. And I mean, you do it slow at first, and then you just, you know, increase as your range of motion increases. And this is great. I mean,
wow.
Just, you know, in the air after, I can feel when my wrists and my forearms are pumped, are ready to go.
No kidding.
So, you know, same thing, both hands. So this one's very common, but this one.
Not so much.
Kind of an odd one, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Don't do it in the metro too much.
I was going to say, what are you doing? Oh, I'm just practicing drums. Come on.
It looks kind of freaky, but man, you know, anything that helps is great.
Yeah.
Okay, so for the feet, I'm going to raise up the pants here a little bit. Okay, so I don't know if we can capture the feet here.
Yeah, we okay. Got the foot count.
Okay,
excellent. There you go.
There you go. So you see this motion where I'm just kind of rolling off the ball of my foot? Well, that's lifting my leg. And I'm hardly using my quads. And actually, my whole muscle area or leg area here is very loose. You know, kind mm-hmm. of like a bowl of Jell-O.
Yeah.
So, first exercise that you can do without a pedal or whatever is just that, exaggerated. So really try to lift. You're kind of like jumping on one leg, sitting down.
Yeah.
So when you jump, you're actually you're doing that same motion. You're rolling off, you know, the ball of your foot. Your heel comes up first, rolls off the ball, and you go up and you land flat. Same kind of thing, but with both legs. Therefore, you're working the ankle right away, okay? Mm-hmm. You're really working the ankle area, mm-hmm. and you're not burning out working quads. Mm-hmm. Now, you can do quads if you want, go like this. And now you're working just hip flexors, and you see how the motion is a lot flatter? It goes like this instead of going like this?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the important one for me, okay? Now, what do you do to work the shin mm-hmm. muscle? Because that controls your ankle movement too. Well, heels down, very simply. Now in doing heels down, you can do it kind of slow at first and try to exaggerate lifting up your foot. And I mean, if you do this for 15 seconds, you should feel a burn automatically if you're not used to doing it.
Yeah.
So the first one and this one, you do, you know, until you feel a burn, you stop for 30 seconds, do it again, maybe three sets, you know, do it three times.
Yeah.
And the last one is really the both combined, if you wish, where you would just lift your leg up. So here you're using hip flexor.
Yeah.
And you just use your ankle.
Gotcha. Yeah.
And again, exaggerate, kind of come down hard, you know what I mean? Exaggerate the motion. But make sure that leg is not moving at all. So it's really just ankle. And it's kind of hard to do off both at a time. So I would just take it one at a time and practice that until you get the burn.
Great warm-up,
I mean,
for it,
you know, the more you do it, the easier it becomes, mm-hmm. you know? And it's all applicable afterwards to the pedals. And when you do the endurance exercise and the speed exercise, I recommend that you do heels up and then heels down, mm-hmm. you know, at the same kind of BPM. And even doing the heel-toe thing that actually you and Jared talked about mm-hmm. and explained very well, by the way, doing that motion works all of those things as well.
Yeah.
So you get a good, you know, burn from that and a great workout from that as well. The whole point is to try to utilize as many muscles that are included or used in what we play so that when we do have to revert back to a muscle that, you know, that is stronger than one or one burns out and it's having that, you know, even doing traditional grip actually works your forearms in this kind of motion. Mm-hmm. So you kind of feel the burn like this. Mm-hmm. So you're doing that and then all of a sudden you go back to match and you're like, oh, that's great. But what do people not do?
Traditional with their right hand.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So if you do it with your right hand, okay. you're gonna get that same kind of thing. It's always a mirror thing, you know what I mean?
It's very cool hearing tips like this from someone who has their ticket as a personal trainer, who studied the muscle development and how it all works. Because as drummers, I mean, for me too, as I would just do something and hope that it would work, right? And
trial and error.
Trial and error. Trial it's and the error. University of trial and error. Right?
Exactly.
Okay, so let's get you to play something.
Sure.
We've got another track, and this one's not from your band. Well, it's from a project you work
it's
with.
It's from another band called Digital Doomsday out of Regina, Saskatchewan. It's kind of like a hip-hop metal mix, and I think this song is Armageddon Legends. Armageddon Legends. It's a really kind of slow but really heavy feel to it, and I kind of like do improv on it if I'm hearing it properly in clinics and stuff because it's just fun to goof around. So, okay. I mean, a lot of it's improv, you know, whatever happens, happens. But I'll try to play that for you. And what I'm going to do is because I had on the TM-2, I had a patch for the Cryptopsy song, which is more of an attack for the bass drums and a little bit for the snare. So for this song, which is heavier and kind of, you know, wider, I'm going to switch the patch and have a bigger bass drum sound and
cool
and what have you.
Awesome. And while he's playing that, guys, if you guys have questions, and there's probably tons already in there, get them in now and we'll get to all the questions after this.
Awesome.
Digital Doomsday, Armageddon Legends.
This was the result of something that was planned. Associates blinded by assumptions and protection.
was awesome. Digital doomsday.
Eh, it's just a little bit of fun improvisation.
That was an awesome song. Okay, so I'll let you catch your breath. We'll get to some questions here. And we got a lot of them that came through. But first off, before we get right into it, we've had a lot of people asking about, first off, that one pedal that's to the left of your hi-hat.
Yes.
They're all asking, what is that pedal? They'd never seen it before. And you're also mentioning the TM-2 at the very beginning of the lesson. Somebody's asked about that as well. So why don't you talk a little bit about those two?
Okay. Things. Well, the Roland pedal on my left here is a prototype. And, the KT-10, it's called. I think there's only two of it in Canada so far. And I had the good fortune of having Darren from Roland let me borrow it. So I do this like ostinato kind of thing during solo sometimes in clinics, where I do like a five, beat pattern. And you can put any sound you want to this. You can even use it as a controller if you wish, but this thing feels amazing. And I don't know what to say. I got to use it more. I got to try things with it.
Yeah.
I'm just like a kid at, Toys R Us.
No
right
kidding.
Now.
Yeah.
So,
and I've played that myself too, or even just sitting here, and it feels unbelievable. For an electronic trigger pedal, it's probably one of the best I've ever felt.
And it's adjustable, right?
Yeah.
So, super.
You can awesome. Do the slide technique, heel toe on that, which is not doable for some of the other pedals that I've played on. So, it's awesome. What about the TM-2?
So, the TM-2 is a new thing too. Do we have it on camera? I think we might be able to show it maybe later on or something. This thing is this big, okay? It's a trigger brain. You can trigger up to four stereo sounds at the same time without any faulty triggering or what have you. It's just amazing. So rather than having this big rack mount and big, or a big pad or whatever to trigger your bass drums or your snare or your kit or whatever. It's all in there. The sounds are amazing. Super, super ingenious thing. You can import your own sounds.
Yes.
So let's say you record your album and you're like, oh, I love my bass drum sound, on this album. And there you go.
There it is right there for awesome. Anybody who wants to see it.
So this is how small it is.
Yeah.
We were talking about efficiency before and... This is, you don't need another suitcase for your triggering system anymore. You know, you don't need to lug it around. You put it anywhere.
And a lot of metal drummers trigger their bass drum.
So. Most metal drummers trigger their bass drum.
Yeah.
And it's just for convenience sake live, so they can hear them live, so the guitar players can hear them live, because it really cuts them, close. It's so this is what this does and tons of other, things. You can import your sound. You like your album sound, import your album sound. Your live sound will sound like your album sound. There's, there's 50 hours that you can put into this.
Wow.
As far as sounds go.
Yeah.
So let's say I was to not want to do, let's say the SPD-SX for a show for convenience sake, because I'm going to, Indonesia.
Sure. Yeah.
And it's going to be super expensive to bring an extra luck.
Sure.
I can put different patches on this with all my click tracks. All my bass drum sounds, all the extras that I want. I have the bar triggers here too, if I want to, like an explosion or some kind of effect, or if I want to trigger even a sampler. So I can put all my stuff on this and just go with this and my acoustic triggers, which I usually bring anyways.
Yeah.
So really an amazing little toy that's super small, super efficient, and super inexpensive.
Yes, that's the cool part about it. And they're coming out, I think they're coming out like within the next month. That's April 2014 right now, so it's coming out very soon.
Very shortly.
We've had a couple other Drumeo instructors talk about it on the lessons too, so look out for that. But let's get to some questions about metal drumming and endurance and all that. Here's one from Freaky. He says... he says, do you think it's hard to be creative with death metal considering the high speed? Because to me, it seems like many death metal drummers are just throwing blast beats and insanely fast singles or double strokes around the kit.
Yeah, and it's a great question that we touched on, saying that it's kind of hard to be, not to be creative, because, if you really want to push yourself, there's a fine line between creativity and overplaying and getting away from what the music calls for as well. So we gotta be careful when we talk about that. If there's a certain guitar part calls for a certain something that's gotta be done because it's just too obvious, then you either do it or you don't. Mm-hmm. Or you do both. I would do both. And that's just being, I guess, just a little bit more creative so that there's more to work with, you know? The music that it calls for and the music that's opposite of it or it doesn't call for. Anyways, it is very hard. Blast beats and double bass and fast stuff is usually a part of it, but it's not to say that you'll be any, you know, less good if you use your creativity and incorporate out of a blast really interesting grooves and interesting feels where you can do more fills and more time signature kind of fills. All that does is that when you go back to playing faster, it just sounds like it's going up instead of just being super linear like the whole time. Yeah. So, you know, being creative is also playing with different times and playing with tempos in order to accentuate something that's fast or accentuate something that's slower and heavier. So there's a huge range in creativity. And again, just listening to all sorts of different music kind of opens you up to being able to dab into these different like pools, you know?
Yeah.
Like, let's think of it a kitchen with tons of stuff. Just grab and then throw it in your melting pot and become, you know, a little bit more original, a little bit more creative. If you just take that one spice and you always use it all the time, well then, you know, let's be, if you like one drummer and you try to emulate that drummer all the time, chances are you're gonna sound like that drummer. So try to get, you know, a whole bunch of different
broaden
stuff.
Your horizons. And, yeah.
Right, exactly.
Good question here from Bobrek. Says, hey, great lesson, Flo. He says, what do you do to achieve such crazy finger speed with your cymbals?
Okay.
Probably talking about the blasts, I guess. Yeah,
and that's just, you know, it's a combination, especially like we just established from my left hand that has a little bit of a stronger wrist. It's a combination of wrist rebound and fingers. So for the right hand, than wrist, but it's my snare is pretty tight, and I want that because I want that response. I want that stick to come back up, and when that stick comes back up, my fingers just follow it, and then at one point I decide, you got to go back down, and my fingers, you know, snap it back down. I'll go a little bit slower so you can see the motion. There's a little bit of wrist involved. And then when it gets kind of like, you know, a little bit faster, it's more stiff and it's just kind of like the fingers really focusing on that, on catching that rebound. So after you push your wrists to a maximum that you can go in the speed building exercises, then start incorporating the fingers. And you'll see that at one point, it'll be more so fingers, but we're talking about for a span of maybe 30 to 40 BPMs more as opposed to, you know, 180 BPMs that you can do by pushing your wrists alone, so.
Gotcha. Another great question here. This one's from Pro Keon. Sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong, but he says, is there a specific reason why you like chain-driven pedals? Most metal drummers prefer direct drive, he says.
That's a great question. I just like that the feeling of a pedal that kind of goes around, you know, a half circle kind of motion. And maybe it's because I do like to play hard and I do like to play grooves. And unfortunately, with the pedals that I've tried, and I'm not an expert in trying out pedals, mm-hmm. but I have tried some that were direct drive, and I just find that that kind of feel, traditional kind of groove feel that I want when I'm not playing super fast, I don't get it with a direct drive pedal. And it's a completely different adaptation of my muscles, which can be changed, obviously. We talked about that. But for me, it's not, it doesn't feel good. I know that some pedals are designed for speed, and if you do the work to utilize them for that, sure, you can go up by, you know, 10, 20 BPMs, but I like a pedal that can do a little bit of both, that can go fast. And I mean, at one point, there's only, personally, there's only a certain level of speed that I really want to reach. I'm not even there yet, but I mean, there's, you know, there's only so fast, and then it just becomes kind of like white noise, which is not really musical. So pedal style for me is just, I just like a traditional kind of feel. I like to have the speedy edge, but that traditional feel. Very
cool.
Simply.
Yeah, no, makes sense. Blake from Montreal asks,
hey, Blake, I knew he'd ask a question.
So you know him, okay. Yeah. He says, what are your thoughts on using double strokes in kick drums for speed?
Okay, this is where we can compare a lot of things that we've talked about. It's the heel-toe double thing is really cool. I mean, it's something that's definitely interesting to work on, not necessarily to use it in your music, but just, you know, to develop your legs and another muscle group, if you wish. The problem with that, and especially on the kit I'm playing now, is if I'm playing a single acoustic bass drum, or even a double acoustic bass drum, I got to crank up my heads really tight to get that rebound, to get the speeds that you want to reach ideally in that kind of music. You also got to stuff it a little bit with pillows and blankets and stuff like that, so it's kind of dead. So the natural sound goes, okay? So if you don't always want to detune your bass drums, and you know, and you're playing different styles, let's say, with different projects, if you don't want to be like taking out blankets, ripping your front head, and detune, the TM-2 is ideal for that, because you can get that large, big bass drum sound without necessarily changing the feel of that tight skin. So, I mean, if we're talking like heel toe kind of thing, I'll try to get a little bit faster, but. Without a proper triggering system, it's going to sound kind of like, you know, and without the right practice too, it's going to sound kind of shady. A double stroke by itself, which would be, you know, back and forth, has to be kind of like really worked on a lot, and that's a different thing. And I totally recommend trying this just for the dexterity of your feet, just to make them, you know, just like your hands. I mean, you know, you'll get faster if you practice paradiddles, and if you practice doubles, you'll get faster singles.
Yeah.
It's just normal. So not necessarily include them, to get back to Blake's question, but practice them, practice paradiddles, practice heel toe, practice, you know, heeled up doubles to make your singles, or, I mean, make your feet that much more equipped to play singles fast or slow or what have you.
Gotcha. Neil Drums also asks, or not also asks, does ask, he says, fantastic lesson, Flo. His question's about your pedal setup. He says, what is your spring tension, beater angle, and footboard angle? Is there anything that you would have to say about that with regards to how fast you go?
Again, just more traditional. Not too tight, not too loose. You know, the footboard is pretty much how it came out of the box. On these particular ones, I kind of tried cranking up the springs a little bit because I used them at home as far as practice. But usually it's, like I said, you know, kind of in between. Not too loose, but not too tight. I want to get a good response out of it. And that's always, from pedal to pedal, it's an ongoing thing. You know, it's the trial and error thing again, and trying this, and then all of a sudden you don't feel comfortable. The whole point of these exercises, and the whole point of really putting in the time, is so as not to have this waste of time of questioning yourself and questioning your equipment, is to be as consistent from day to day as possible. And it's not, I'm not saying you're always going to be on top of your game, or, you know, or bad, or the whole point is to put in the time to be able to be as consistent as possible, because there's nothing worse than that feeling like, you know, you just had a great gig the night before, yep. and then you sit down and you just can't even play a note properly. And that's happened to me in the past, and I tried to eliminate that. But with my playing factors. Now, there's outside factors. I mean, there's sleep. There's yeah. what you eat. There's what you drink. Yeah. I mean, there's a whole bunch of things. But, I mean, if you can, you know, correct one, that's one step to,
exactly.
To consistency.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, we got one last question because we're already 20 minutes over. Oh. Okay. And then I'm going to get you to play us out with another song.
It's going to be a short one, too.
It's going to be a short one?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a shame, man.
Well, no, it's, I mean, we're over. I mean, sorry.
Hey, but there's always time for playing, all right?
Okay.
It's the questions that get cut.
Sure.
But okay, so here's one last question. This is from a fan, and it says, I can't pronounce your name, B-B-H-A-U-G-E, Bhug. But I have terrible pronunciation, so
I'm not going to try.
Yeah. He says, can you explain how you got the bass drum sound that you got on the Unspoken King album? That is still one of the best, if not the best, bass drums I've heard to this day. Not too clicky. Sounds really good for fast patterns and slow. If you can share a little bit of insight on that.
I think that because Chris Donaldson, my guitar player, who does, you know, most of my sounds for anything I do, any project, any band that asks me to record on, you know, he'll take it and he'll, by the way, his new studio, The Grid in Montreal is fabulous. Go check it out, record. He'll take a natural sound and maybe add on to it, maybe, you know, as far as play with the hertz and the attack and all that stuff. And sometimes he'll combine it with another sound. So that particular one from that album that's mentioned, I don't really recall how it was done or if it was kept. I think that we changed the sound afterwards, but we're always trying like different things until we find one that we really, really dig. And it's usually a combination of things. It's really a combination of sounds. Mm-hmm. And then you can take that sound, which you really dig, and then shove it into the TM-2, and I mean, you can play it live and what have you. So it's important to find your sound, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it's important to have that that power and control in order to make your drum sound good, because a good drum sound is usually going to motivate you to play better, you know? So yeah, sound is important. Good question.
Yeah, very good question. And there's been three or four people that have asked, so I'll have to get this one into, what kind of snare are you using?
That's another great question. I'm using a Unix snare. It's a company out of Montreal, actually not too far from where I live. The designer's name is Frank. And it's a great little kind of like concept that we're trying to work on, and maybe it'll develop into a custom signature snare.
That would be awesome, yeah.
Just a maple snare, but with the specifics that we had worked on and I'd asked for. And so yeah, Unix drums.
Very cool. Dave Warfel, one of your biggest fans, says hi.
Excellent, hi.
Yes. All right, let's get to a play
I'm
along.
Back.
Yeah, exactly. Let's get to the play along. So, are you playing that one last song? And what song is it? This is from.
This is Cryptopsy.
Cryptopsy, okay.
And it is a song called Worship Your Demons from The Unspoken King, actually. So,
awesome.
Thank you very much, Dave.
No, thank you so much for coming out.
It is a big honor, and thanks a lot for letting me talk and share ideas.
Thought it was really cool hearing those, the muscle and all that advice that you were talking about coming from a trader, you know, it's kind of cool, yeah.
2+2 logic, I call it. It's just very simple stuff, but that's the simple stuff that's the foundation of what people need to know, I guess.
Cool. All right, well, let's get to the song, and thanks everybody for coming out, watching live. Sorry if you didn't get to all the questions, again, if you like the lesson, rate it, and hope to see you guys around for the next one. I'll see you guys all later.
Thank you.